our basic concept with respect to space is the idea of a three-dimensional space. This is an invention done by René Descartes. It was in the 17th century. But the centuries before, nobody had this idea. They had quite different concepts of space. For instance, one of the basic ideas was the concept of spheres. So, the middle of the universe, the center of the universe was Earth. Then you had spheres like onions around them. You had the spheres of elements, then moon, then the planets, then sun, then Thulium Stellatum, all the stars in the spheres, and then would come the spheres of heaven, the hierarchy of angels, archangels, and so on, and the last one would be God. So this is a continuum of quite different spaces. The way this one space is organized is different, is qualitatively separated from the other. So the idea to put in all this one scale and to meter it, it has no meaning, because space is qualitatively different. Space cannot be bridged by one scale. Of course, people had a spatial orientation, but this spatial orientation is just one aspect of space, but it's not the main aspect of space.
What made you interested in space, and the concept of space?
I'm a cultural historian working at the Johannes Kepler University of Linz, and I'm dealing with the history of concepts. So, for me, it is interesting to study the hypothesis that the history of concepts is interwoven with the history of perception as well. Let me try to explain it with an example of an object. What is an object? An object for us is a single unity. It is stated in an outside world. My feelings with respect to this object has nothing to do with the object per se. It's separated from me. I and the object are different entities. And if I ask what it is, I have to ask natural sciences. They would tell me what this is. But all these sentences couldn't be understood by the wisest people in the early Middle Ages. Nobody would understand it. What's an object in the early Middle Ages? An object is an entity who has an inner value. He has an inner meaning. He has an intention per se. For instance, look at the color green. And this green is connected with greens in plants, in trees. It has to do with the green in your jacket. So the idea is that an object is embedded into a huge symbolic net. And this net has something to do with me. For instance, if I would wear a green trousers, this green and this green would be connected. So people are not separated from the world. People are very deeply embedded in the world, and space has a quite different meaning. The feelings they have with respect to object has to do with the objects per se. To feel the world is to detect the world. Feeling is no psychic process. Feeling has something to do with objects. It has something to do with space. So we could term this as an felt space or a feeling space in some way. The concept of mental space had something to do with imagination. But in cultural history, one can say that cultural space or the cultural concept of space is a cultural imagination. So people live always in an imagined world and looking at the concepts behind this imagined world could us help to explain the world. And this should and could be done with our ordinary world as well. So what are the basic concepts we live in? We do not speak about them. They are self-evident entities. They are self-evident way of thinking. They are self-evident way of orientation in the world. One of the most interesting thing for me in the cultural history of perception is that the concept of the outside world and the inside world has dramatically changed. So what, of course, we must draw a border. We must say, this is outside and my feeling, my thoughts, my intentions are inside. We must do it. If we can't do it, we would not be able to share cultural experiences with most people. But this border has shifted dramatically. For instance, a good example is the concept, the idea of possession. What does it mean? If maybe 1,000 years ago, if I would get mentally ill, people would say, "Oh, and demon from the outside world is coming to me. He's sitting inside my body and he is doing with me some strange things." So I wouldn't be responsible for my strange behavior, but the demon would be. And the therapeutical practice would be directed to the demon. Priests would speak with him and maybe they would talk to me, only my body, not my soul. And then the demon could go away and I could be healthy as well. In modern times, a strange behavior would be interpreted as a psychic illness. So this is the concept of the inner world. The same behavior would be interpreted as something stemming from the inside world. In the Middle Ages, one would say it's coming from the outside world. And there are many, many examples. One example is the concept of a dream. What's a dream? In ancient times, like in Greek, they had the idea, a daemon bring me the dream. So I am not inside a dream. I'm looking at the dream. Because the dream is coming from outside. A god would come to me and would me give a dream, and so on. And the Greek had the idea that gods would give people creativity. Gods would be responsible to be able to write a book or to produce music, and so on.